Hello, my darling, and welcome to today's story time. Today we are reading The Sleeping Beauty in the Wood by Charles Perrault. Once upon a time, there lived a king and a queen who were green. More green than words can tell, because they had no children. They tried the waters of every country, made vows and pilgrimages, and did everything that could be done, but without result. At last, however, the queen found that her wishes were fulfilled, and in due course, she gave birth to a daughter. A grand christening was held, and all the fairies that could be found in the realm, they numbered 7 in all, were invited to be godmothers to the little princess. This was done so that by means of the gifts, which each turn would bestow upon her in accordance with the fairy customs of those days, the princess might be endowed with every imaginable perfection. When the christening ceremony was over, all the company returned to the king's palace, where a great banquet was held in honor of the fairies. Places were laid for them in magnificent style, and before each was placed a solid gold casket containing a spoon, fork, and knife of fine gold, set with diamonds and rubies. But just as all were sitting down to a table, an aged fairy was seen to enter, whom no one had thought to invite. The reason being that for more than 50 years, she never left the tower in which she lived, and people had supposed her to be dead or bewitched. By the king's orders, a place was laid for her, but it was impossible to give her a golden casket like the others, for only 7 had been made for the 7 invited fairies. The old creature believed that she was intentionally slighted, and muttered threats between her teeth. She was overheard by one of the young fairies, who was seated nearby. The latter, guessing that some mischievous gift might be bestowed upon the little princess, hid behind the tapestry as soon as the company left the table. Her intention was to be the last to speak, and so to have the power of counteracting, as far as possible, any evil which the old fairy might do. Presently, the fairies began to bestow their gifts upon the princess. The youngest ordained that she should be the most beautiful person in the world. The next, that she should have the temper of an angel. The third, that she should do everything with wonderful grace. The fourth, that she should dance to perfection. The fifth, that she should sing like a nightingale. And the sixth, that she should play every kind of music with the utmost skill. It was now the turn of the aged fairy. Shaking her head, in token of spite rather than of infirmity, she declared that the princess should prick her hand with a spindle and die because of it. A shudder ran through the company at this terrible gift. All eyes were filled with tears. But at this moment, the young fairy stepped forth from behind the tapestry. "Take comfort, your majesty," she said in a loud voice. "Your daughter shall not die. My power, it is true, is not enough to undo all that my aged kinswoman has decreed. The princess will indeed prick her hand with a spindle, but instead of dying, she shall merely fall into a profound slumber that will last 100 years. At the end of that time, the king's son shall come and awaken her. The king, in an attempt to avert the unhappy doom pronounced by the old fairy, at once published an edict forbidding all persons, under pain of death, to use a spinning wheel or keep a spindle in the kingdom. At the end of 16 years, the king and queen happened one day to be away on a pleasure bent, the princess was running about the castle and going upstairs from room to room. She came at length to a garret at the top of a tower, where an old serving woman sat alone with her distaff, spinning. This good old woman had never heard of the king's proclamation forbidding the use of spinning wheels. "What are you doing, my good woman?" asked the princess. "I am spinning, my pretty child," she said, not realizing it was the princess. "Oh, what fun," rejoiced the princess. "How do you do it? Let me try and see if I can do it equally well." Partly because she was too hasty, partly because she was a little reckless, but really because the fairy decree had ordained it. No sooner had she seized the spindle than she pricked her hand and fell down in a swoon. In great alarm, the old woman cried out for help. People came running from every quarter to the princess. They threw water on her face, chafed her with their hands, and rubbed her temples with the royal essence of Hungary, but nothing would restore her. Then the king, who had been brought upstairs by the commotion, remembered the fairy's prophecy. Feeling certain that what had happened was inevitable, since the fairy had decreed it, he gave orders that the princess should be placed in the finest apartment in the palace, upon a bed embroidered in gold and silver. He would have thought her an angel, so fair was she to behold. The trance had not taken away the lovely color of her complexion. Her cheeks were delicately flushed, her lips like coral. Her eyes, indeed, were closed, but her gentle breathing could be heard, and therefore, it was plain she was not dead. The king commanded that she should be left to sleep in peace until the hour of her awakening should come. When the accident happened to the princess, the good fairy who had saved her life by condemning her to sleep 100 years was in the kingdom Mataquin, 12,000 leagues away. She was instantly warned of this, however, by a small dwarf who had a pair of 7-league boots, which are boots that enable one to cover 7 leagues in a single step. The fairy set off at once, and within an hour her chariot of fire, drawn by dragons, was seen approaching. The king handed her down from the chariot, and she approved of all that had been done. But being gifted with great powers of foresight, she bethought herself that when the princess came to be awakened, she would be much distressed to find herself all alone in the castle, with everyone dead. And this is what the fairy did. She touched her wand on everybody except the king and queen, who was in the castle, governesses, maids of honor, ladies-in-waiting, gentlemen, officers, stewards, cooks, scullions, errand boys, guards, porters, pages, footmen. She touched likewise all of the horses in the stable with their grooms, the big mastiffs in the courtyard, and Small Puff, the pet dog of the princess, who was lying on the bed beside his mistress. The moment she had touched them, they all fell asleep, to awaken only at the same moment as their mistress. Thus they would always be ready with their service whenever she should require it. The very spits before the fire, loaded with partridges and pheasants, subsided into slumber, and the fire as well. All was done in one moment, for the fairy did not take long to do her work. Then the king and queen kissed their dear child without waking her and left the castle. Proclamations were issued forbidding any to approach it. These warnings were not needed, for within a quarter of an hour there grew up all around the park so vast a quantity of trees, large and small, with interlacing brambles and thorns, that neither man nor beast could penetrate them. The tops alone of the castle towers could be seen, and these only from a distance. Thus did the fairy's magic contrive that the princess, during all of the time of her slumber, should have naught to fear from prying eyes. At the end of 100 years, the throne had passed to another family from that of the sleeping princess. One day the king's son chanced to go a-hunting that way, and seeing in a distance some towers in the midst of a large and dense forest, he asked what they were. His attendants told him in reply various stories which they had heard. Some said there was an old castle haunted by ghosts, others that all of the witches in the neighborhood held their revels there. The favorite tale was that in the castle lived an ogre who carried thither all the children whom he could catch. There he devoured them at his leisure, and since he was the only person who could force a passage through the wood, nobody had ever been able to pursue him. While the prince was wondering what to believe, an old peasant took up the tale. "Your Highness," said he, "more than 50 years ago, I heard my father say that in this castle lies a princess, the most beautiful that has ever been seen. It is her doom to sleep there for 100 years, and then to be awakened by a king's son, for whose coming she waits." This story fired up the young prince. He jumped immediately to the conclusion that it was for him to see so happy an adventure through, and impelled alike by the wish for love and glory, he resolved to set about it on the spot. Hardly had he taken a step towards the wood when the tall trees, the brambles and the thorns, separated of themselves and made a path for him. He turned in the direction of the castle and spied it at the end of a long avenue. This avenue he entered and was surprised to notice that the trees closed up again as soon as he had passed, so that none of his retinue were able to follow him. A young and gallant prince is always brave, however, so he continued on his way, and presently he reached a large forecourt. The sight that now met his gaze was enough to fill him with an icy fear. The silence of the place was dreadful, and death seemed all about him. The recumbent figures of men and animals had all of the appearance of being completely lifeless, but as he walked closer, he perceived by the pimply noses and ruddy faces of the porters that they were merely sleeping. It was plain, too, from their glasses, in which there were still some dregs of wine, that many had fallen asleep while drinking. The prince made his way into a great courtyard paved with marble, and mounting the staircase, he entered the guardroom. Here the guards were lined up on either side in two ranks, their muskets on their shoulders, snoring their hardest. He walked through several apartments, crowded with ladies and gentlemen in waiting, some seated, some standing, but all asleep. So he pushed on, and so came at last to a chamber which was decked out all in gold. There he encountered the most beautiful sight he had ever seen. Reclining upon a bed, the curtains of which on every side were drawn back, was a princess of seemingly 16 summers, whose radiant beauty had almost an unearthly luster. Trembling in his admiration, he drew near and went on his knees beside her. At that same moment, the hour of disenchantment having come, the princess awoke and bestowed upon him a look more tender than a first glance might seem to warrant. "Is it you, dear prince?" she asked. "You have been long in coming." Charmed by these words, and especially by the manner in which they were said, the prince scarcely knew how to express his delight and gratification. He declared that he loved her better than he loved himself. His words were faltering, but they pleased her the more for that. The less there is of eloquence, the more there is of love. Her embarrassment was less than his. And that is not to be wondered at, since she had had time to think of what she would say to him. It seems, although the fairy never said this, that the good fairy had beguiled her long slumber with pleasant dreams. To be brief, after 4 hours of talking, they had not succeeded in uttering one half of the things they had to say to each other. Now the whole palace had awakened with the princess. Everyone went about his business, and since they were not all in love, they presently began to feel mortally hungry. The lady-in-waiting, who was suffering like the rest, at length lost patience, and in a loud voice called out to the princess that supper was served. The princess was already fully dressed, and in most magnificent style. As he helped her to rise, the prince refrained from telling her that her clothes, with the straight collar which she wore, were like those to which his grandmother had been accustomed. But in truth, they no way detracted from her beauty. They passed into an apartment hung with mirrors, and were there served with supper by the stewards of the household, while the fiddles and oboes played some old music, and played it remarkably well, considering they had not played for 100 years. Some time later, when supper was over, the chaplain married them in the castle chapel, and in due course, attended by the courtiers in waiting, they retired to rest. They slept but little, however. The princess, indeed, had no need of sleep, and as soon as morning came, the prince took his leave of her. He returned to the city and told his father, who was awaiting him with some anxiety, that he had lost himself while hunting in the forest, but had obtained some bread and cheese from a charcoal burner in whose hovel he had passed the night. His royal father, being of an easygoing nature, believed this tale, but his mother was not so easily hoodwinked. She noticed that he went hunting every day, and that he always had an excuse handy when he slept 2 or 3 nights from home. She felt certain, therefore, that he had a love affair. 2 whole years passed since the marriage of the prince and princess, and during that time they had 2 children. First, a daughter named Dawn, while the second, a boy, was named Day, because he seemed even more beautiful than his sister. Many a time the queen told her son that he ought to settle down in life. She tried in this way to make him confide in her, but he did not dare to trust her with his secret. Despite the affection which he bore her, he was afraid of his mother, for she came from a race of ogres, and the king had only married her for her wealth. It was whispered at the court that she had ogreish instincts, and that when little children were near her, she had the greatest difficulty in the world to keep from pouncing on them. No wonder the prince was reluctant. At the end of 2 years, the king died, and the prince found himself on the throne. He then made public announcement of his marriage, and went in state to fetch his royal consort from her castle. With her 2 children, she made a triumphal entry into the capital of her husband's realm. Sometime afterwards, the king declared war on his neighbor, Emperor Cantalupe. He appointed the queen mother as regent in his absence, and entrusted his wife and children to her care. He expected to be away at the war for the entire summer, and as soon as he was gone, the queen mother sent her daughter-in-law and the 2 children to a country mansion in the forest. This she did, that she might be able, more easily, to gratify her horrible longings. A few days later, she went in there, and in the evening summoned the chief steward. "For my dinner tomorrow," she told him, "I will eat dawn." "Oh, madam," exclaimed the steward, "That is my will," said the queen. And she spoke in the tones of an ogre who longs for raw meat. "We will serve her with a piquant sauce," she added. The poor man, seeing plainly that it was useless to trifle with an ogress, took his big knife and went up to little Dawn's chamber. She was at that time 4 years old, and when she came running with a smile to greet him, flinging her arms around his neck and coaxing him to give her some sweets, he burst into tears and let the knife fall from his hand. Presently, he went down to the yard behind the house and slaughtered a young lamb. For this he made so delicious a sauce that his mistress declared she had never eaten anything so good. At the same time, the steward carried little Dawn to his wife and bade the latter hide her in the quarters which they had below the yard. 8 days later, the wicked queen summoned her steward again. "For my supper," she announced, "I will eat day." The steward made no answer, being determined to trick her, as he had done previously. He went in search of little Day, whom he found with a tiny foil in his hands, making brave passes, though he was but 3 years old. He carried him off to his wife, who stowed him away in hiding with Dawn. To the ogress, the steward served up, in place of Day, a young kid so tender that she found it surpassingly delicious. So far, so good. But there came an evening, and this evil queen again addressed the steward. "I have a mind," she said, "to eat the queen with the same sauce as you served with our children." This time, the poor steward despaired of being able to practice another deception. The young queen was 20 years old. That is, without counting the 100 years she had been asleep. Her skin, though white and beautiful, had become tough. And what animal could he possibly find that would correspond to her? He made up his mind that if it would save his own life, he must kill the queen. So he went upstairs to her apartment, determined to do the deed once and for all. Voting himself into a rage, he drew his knife and entered the young queen's chamber. But a reluctance to give her no moment of grace made him repeat respectfully the command which he had received from the queen mother. "Do it then," she cried. "Do it. Carry out the order you have been given. Then once more, I shall see my children. My poor children who I love so much." Nothing had been said to her when the children were stolen away, and she believed them to be dead. The poor steward was overcome by compassion. "No, no, madam," he declared. "You shall not die, but you shall certainly see your children again. That will be in my quarters, where I have hidden them. I should make the queen eat a young hind in place of you, and thus trick her once more." Without more ado, he led her to his quarters, and left her there to embrace and weep over her children, proceeding to cook a hind with such art that the queen mother ate it for supper with as much appetite as if it had indeed been the young queen. The queen mother felt well satisfied with her cruel deeds and planned to tell the king on his return, but savage wolves had devoured his consort and his children. It was her habit, however, to prowl often about the courts and alleys of the mansion in the hope of scenting raw meat. And one evening, she heard the boy Day crying in a basement cellar. The child was weeping because his mother had threatened to whip him for some naughtiness. And she heard at the same time the voice of Dawn begging forgiveness for her brother. The ogress recognized the voices of the queen and her children and was enraged to find that she had been tricked. The next morning, in tones so frightening that all trembled, she ordered a huge vat to be brought into the middle of the courtyard. This she filled with vipers and toads, with snakes and serpents of every kind, intending to cast into it the queen and her children, and the steward and his wife, and the serving girl. By her command, these were brought forward, with their hands tied behind their backs. There they were, and her minions were making ready to cast them into the vat. When into the courtyard rode the king. Nobody had expected him so soon, but he had traveled post-haste. Filled with amazement, he demanded to know what this horrible spectacle meant. No one dared tell him, and at that moment the ogress, enraged at what confronted her, threw herself head foremost into the vat, and was devoured on the instant by the hideous creature she placed in it. The king could not but be sorry, for after all, she was his mother. But it was not long before he found ample consolation in his beautiful wife and children. The moral of the story. Many a girl has waited long for a husband, brave or strong. But I'm sure I never met any sort of woman yet who could wait 100 years, free from fretting, free from fears. Now our story seems to show that a century or so, late or early, matters not. True love comes by fairy lot. Some old folk will even say, it grows better by delay. If this good advice, I fear, helps us neither there nor here. Though philosophers may prate, how much wiser 'tis to wait. Maids will be a sighing still. Young blood must, when young blood will. The end.